Danny Prashana from Blizz Planet. I'm here with John Hodgson, technical designer for Heroes of the Storm.
That's right, yeah.
How are you enjoying BlizzCon so far?
Loving it so far.
Yeah.
It's really exciting.
What's your favorite thing that you guys have announced so far for your team?
For my team, Ragnaros, hands down.
Yeah.
I think Ragnaros is a blast of play, no pun intended. I loved the, it's a little bit of a different experience. It's great seeing him as I think the players have just seen him for the first time, big and epic and powerful, and is able to do things that other heroes aren't able to do. But it's also, you know, as a developer, knowing the kind of headaches and heartaches we went through to try to build him and get that fantasy right, get
sure.
the mechanics right, it's really awesome to finally see all of that.
Can you talk a little bit about those headaches and heartaches and what some of the challenges were to build something quite like him?
Well, with all of our heroes, it's always a challenge to do right by the hero, I guess. One of our design tenets is asking yourself, what is the fantasy of the hero? Ragnaros' fantasy means a lot of things to a lot of people. Obviously, 40 Million Mile Raid has shown up a couple of times in the intermediary period in the Firelands expansion, I think it's Cataclysm. And Hearthstone. So he's got a persona about him, and players have a certain expectation of how he would play if he were Heroes, and we try to adapt to that. Originally, he was supposed to be a core replacement hero. So instead of a core, you'd have Ragnaros, and a player would control that. Big, epic, powerful, really crazy abilities, but. We got a lot of negative feedback about it initially, where they said, well, this doesn't really feel like Ragnaros, because I can't use my hammer to do anything. Nobody's around the core until it's the end of the game.
Yeah.
And if there are your core, you're probably losing, right?
Not very interactive at that point.
Exactly. And so we gave him global abilities, so he's truly a global hero, but then complaints went the other way of like, well, he could just nuke me from wherever I am, and it's not fair, right? And he has to be powerful because it's Ragnaros. And so, we wanted to be cognizant about that and of this fantasy, but also do right by the game that we're building here.
Okay.
Balance wise, fantasy wise, tried a couple of other things like, okay, Ragnaros, core, but then he can send out the Sun of Flame that we can control. Or maybe Major Domo Executus, when you can control him, right? And then you can smash him in time to become the Fire Lord. And, those weren't received well either. Like, I signed up to play Ragnaros, not this dorky fire elf.
Right.
So finally, the iteration you see on the show floor today is us accepting, okay, well, yeah, we can make a small version of Ragnaros. You get to play as Ragnaros. He has extremely powerful abilities, and he gets a moment, which is not only important fantastically, for players who want to feel like that character of taking over a building and smashing things and really becoming the raid boss,
right,
as we say. But also really interesting mechanically from a gameplay perspective of, like, I really need to defend this fort. Enemy forces are coming in, but I can save it as Ragnaros and I can fend it off, or I can press an advantage by taking over just the fort that we've just destroyed. If we can just get down this fort, then I can take it over and we can wipe their team. And so it becomes an interesting gameplay moment as well as a very interesting lore and very interesting character.
Absolutely. So what made you guys decide on Ragnaros, though? I remember in the past, you know, there was talk about Deathwing and how we could, you know, bring Deathwing, but it's, again, like, such a big hero. So Ragnaros kind of fits that big hero mold and, you know, how you bring him down into the size that works with the game but doesn't, you know, do a disservice to him. So why Ragnaros over Deathwing or Kel'Thuzad or something else, you know, big?
It's a question that comes up every hero that we do, like why
sure.
this hero instead of that hero. The cards fall wherever they may. It could be a number of reasons, like, well, we really want an assassin character,
okay.
We really want a support character, so that's what's got to be the next hero here. Or maybe we want something from a different maybe we want a female character instead of a male character. There's a lot of different considerations. Sometimes we're thinking about, or sometimes there's an idea that pops in our head, like, yeah, Ragnaros we kind of had, were jiving off of the core replacement idea, and so we're like, well, what could sit at the core like they're immobile naturally, so what could that mean? Maybe Old God, maybe Ragnaros, maybe Dwarvamon from StarCraft, all kinds of things. And Ragnaros was the one who was kind of clicking on the Earth level and mechanical level first. We really just had to pick one, but we'd like to get to as many of them as we can, obviously.
Sure. Did that choice fit in with choosing Varian as well? Did it seem like releasing those two kind of at the same time, having the cinematic and the Warcraft lore and what's happened with Varian, did that play into it at all, or did it just kind of work?
You know, I don't think we made the Varian choice based on Warcraft. I'm not sure even that we were aware that that was the way things were going to go down in Legion when we started working on Varian. We knew Varian's in the popular Warcraft character. We wanted to do a multi-class hero, and we thought, well, we have a number of different directions we can choose for that. Again, just like you said, why would you do this instead of that? Like, there's a lot of different multi-class ideas. You know, like a Warcraft Druid is a perfect example. Maybe we'll do that one day. And we've even got some examples in the game with Monk, the character, get to pick your trait at level 1. That kind of shows a multi-class nature. And characters like Tassadar are kind of multi-class. You can talent them into being more of a support or an assassin character. For Varian, we really tried to double down on that idea.
Okay.
We really tried to make them not just, for example, like support that dabbles at damage or like specialist who is a good pusher but also can deal some damage. We really just wanted, you are a tank or you are an assassin based on the decision, the key decision that you're making.
Okay.
And we will try to see if that works. Does that have interesting draft implications, or does that have interesting team composition or like mind games with enemies? Does that serve the fantasy of a WoW style warrior that can go protection or fury or arms? Like, we were trying to hit on those ideas and areas.
That's what was your motivation behind it, but that's pretty much it, so that's awesome. So then, talking about Karazim, focusing on buffing his ability to Bruiser through the Iron Fist, would you consider changing classification of heroes like him as well, or is it more just like to be more multi-class, or is it just, he is what he is, and Varian is, this new style?
I don't actually know. There's certainly have some thoughts about it. It would be very interesting if you went back and revisit these characters as a multi-class. We're not entirely sure exactly what it means. Like, maybe the Varian idea is really good, but we can't quite get the cause right. It turns out that maybe one of his trees is more powerful, so we need to have this very careful balance game to see if we can get all of that stuff viable for tournament seed.
Sure.
So, like, if we went back and revisited old characters and made them more multi-class, we would need to be very careful about it.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's exciting. I think that it really showcases the benefits of the talent system that we have.
Okay.
We're really making key lead decisions throughout the game that aren't just buffing your base stats, but really changing the way that you play the game.
Right,
on a fundamental level, multi-class is definitely one way to do that.
In comparison to other more flexible heroes like Karazim.
Yeah, like I said, it's something that we want to. Karazim is at his heart going to be a support character.
Right.
In game designer terms, this is a heal. Like, you're kind of expected to use that heal, and it's an AoE, so you're kind of expected to use an allies for full effect. You don't have to. But it's kind of one of our design models is easy to learn, difficult to master. And
right.
So Karazim player, for example, you can heal yourself if you're in a pinch, but it's kind of easy. Like, I'm always going to get this heal in places.
Right.
It'll be the most out of Karazim. You'll be jumping into your team, healing them with this big AoE heal, jumping into the enemy team, punching them, getting props off of your trait. So that you can continue healing, or you can do a little bit of extra damage, and so like that support role is definitely part of the mastery of Karazim. Varian Varian's mastery is going to be because of his multi-classing overall that we anticipate. So okay. Can you understand what your team needs strategically, tactically? Can you read a battlefield situation, understand what a talent's enemy team is going, what your team is going, and where you're building towards, and be able to react to those with various talents. Like, it doesn't just end at his level, his big level 10 choice, whether he's a warrior, or he's a tanky protection warrior, or if he's more of the Sonya style fury warrior, or
sure.
Is vulnerable. Like, he's got another choice at level, it's either 13 or 16, where you can choose a banner.
Mm-hmm.
And the banner is either grants move speed to all of your allies, which is great for melee, if your team is melee heavy, right? So you need to close the gap. He's got banner that increases the ability power level of his teammates, which is great if he's an engage composition. He's got a banner that increases your. That grants all of your team protected. They take 25% less damage for a short period of time. So that would be good if you're the enemy team is really on my composition. So it's not just it's about using the talent system to its fullest extent to read battlefield situations, kind of act like the commander that Baron is.
We'll start
at the
top here.
I did.
What was the most challenging part of building Baron for the team? And how difficult it is to balance him versus just the single class.
Yeah, it's so balance definitely is a concern. I think we got it pretty well, but players always surprise us with what they can find. Getting the balance right for a variant is critical because if one of his classes is better, then players are naturally going to be drawn to that, whether or not it's right for their team composition. Making the character as balanced as possible it has been a challenge, and it remains to be seen whether or not it's going to be a challenge. We have a lot of faith in our balance team. They've been really good guys for it. I guess that's the big thing.
Yeah.
There was a lot of art challenges too.
Okay.
A lot of the hits that we wanted to get out of Varian was having his two swords. So you could split them apart, or you could suddenly get a shield at level 10, and that would require different animation sets that we would have to swap live, which is not something I'm going to do.
Okay.
Like arrows. So I'm not an artist myself, but I understand that was. But we knew it was going to be an epic, amazing moment.
Yeah.
Artists really wanted to do that.
Yeah.
So character, different points in the game. So the passion was behind it.
Sure. It sounds like it's really putting a lot into what makes Varian in WoW. So it's cool to see it translate over to this game as well. Back to Ragnaros. So how does he move around? Does he have a mount? How's that going to work?
So we get to. You get to enable or disable certain mounts depending on the character, right? Like, Asmodan can't get on a horse. So, Ragnaros also can't get on a horse. I think his default mount is he kind of rides a lava wave.
Okay.
It's like this little pump of lava, I guess. You'll have to see it in the game. I'm not sure what else he can use as a mount. I think he might be able to use, like, a leopard disc mount as his thing. It's the Hearthstone coin. But yes, he doesn't know.
Okay.
He gets around that way. He moves normally like a regular hero. He doesn't have legs, but he kind of just moldens the ground wherever he goes.
Gotcha.
He can't move when he's in his epic Molten Core mode.
Okay.
He's stuck at the town, but a lot of his abilities are very extreme range. So
okay.
you can usually hit all the enemies if you're able to lead. Then he had a lot of success with. And then on certain maps, he's able to reach key map of his map.
Oh, okay.
So picking him on a certain map that you know is going to be close. close enough to where key map objectives are close enough to town, so that they're alive or dead.
I'm sure.
Got it.
Cool. Let's talk a little bit about the Black Hearts Revenge Brawl. Mm-hmm. Can you talk about, you know, how Brawl differs from the general rules of the battleground, and you know, why you decided to use?
So it's entirely different map.
Okay.
Like, even though it's using the Black Hearts Bay tile set, it's
sure.
I'm not sure if you got the chance to play it yet.
I haven't played it yet. Okay. No, I'll try to play it.
So it's an attack defend kind of map.
Okay.
In normal Heroes game, right? Everybody's trying to do the same thing to each other, right? Trying
sure.
To
mm-hmm.
And you're competing for map objectives to attain that. But in Black Hearts Revenge, one team is trying to defend their core, and the only way for the enemy team to attack the core is to escort this Black Hearts ghost ship towards the core, and then blow it.
Okay.
So the defending team has to go around and gather the cannonballs, and then load them into cannons and shoot down the ship before it reaches. It's kind of like a weird. We've talked about how we would actually message this for
yeah.
this very moment. Because it's kind of like an Overwatch payload,
okay.
But it's also kind of like a capture the flag.
Yeah, so it's sounded kind of like capture the flag.
Yeah, yeah. So
the fact that it's moving, it has the payload feel to it.
It's a little bit weird to describe, but
okay.
the point of it is, two teams have different map objectives, and the normal Brawl rules of pick a random hero out of the three that we call shovel pick. Pick a random hero out of the three that are presented to you. Death timers are much lower, so you're always in the action. Everybody starts at level 10. So similar to the Brawl, as you would know from the Brawl.
Sure. So with this type of Brawl, do you think this is going to herald more asymmetric maps in general, or is this kind of just a one-off to see how it goes?
I think that we're very interested in continuing to use.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a really interesting design challenge for us. It's a lot of fun. It makes you think about the map differently. And Brawl is a really safe place to do that. Asymmetric maps are pretty tricky for a competitive game where if it's just said that the attacking team has the advantage for some reason, right, or the defending team has the advantage, then we would have to construct some sort of scenario. Sides, maybe.
Sure.
We could think about doing that, but Brawl is a great place to do that now because it's more about having fun, and the random hero selections just kind of throw a wrench into everything, and so we're not really concerned about the balance too much about that. It's just about getting in,
right,
having a really fun 5-minute game, and queuing up again. Maybe you could be the defending side, the attacking side, maybe the hero. Nice.
So I know people are probably excited for Haunted Mines to come back. The crowd seemed excited. So, how did you guys go about the changes and what needed to be done to make that, you know, kind of a viable map again?
Well, there were a couple of issues with the original Haunted Mines. I think they covered some of them during the presentation. One of them is that there's cost pressure on one lane. So, the one lane that's getting destroyed by the Grave Golem is the one that's going to eventually crush the core, and it kind of makes the map feel a little bit
safer. Right.
And another thing, another really key thing is the winning team is very easily able to control the entrance to mines at both entrances.
Okay.
So we tried to address some of those through the map geometry and canvas work. So now the Grave Golem starts in a different position throughout the game. So the first Grave Golem, the enemy team will top lane, the first team will bottom lane, and then they'll switch. I think it follows the rules that Angel and Demon follow.
Okay.
But I'm not 100% sure. And we've also changed the geometry a little bit to include a lot more entrances to the mines. So we're trying to make sure that no one team has a monopoly on all the souls down there. We really like the mechanic. Mm-hmm. We like the excitement that it brings and the predictability and the way that the game flows. But just a couple of changes to the way that the map is laid out, and that is, we found that it's much balanced, it's a lot more fun, and I'd love to bring it back.
Has it tested pretty well internally, at least?
Yes.
Probably have time for cool. So Samaro is pretty popular in Quick Play right now. Seems like he's doing quite well. Do you think his kit is balanced right now? Do you guys think that it needs any adjusting?
We hit him with some nerfs recently. Not sure. That was only last week. Not sure. Or 2 weeks ago. We didn't want to mess too much with the discount stuff. Yeah, I knew we were trying to be careful with the balance. But we hit him with some nerfs recently. Continued to monitor him. Came out pretty strong. He does have some key weaknesses. He's susceptible to CC. Care heroes with detection kind of pretty well. I think there was a post on Reddit recently about how many just kind of pressures him, but not a whole lot of people practice with the yet. So we're going to continue to monitor him. Player stuff is a lot of fun, so we're hitting that pretty well. Obviously, the balance will come.
I guess one last question then. So with Varian being the way he is, which play style do you like to play better personally? Do you like the
assassin? I love playing tanks.
Okay.
Personally. Although, so I'm usually playing tank.
Yeah.
So I'm usually picking his taunt ability, level 10. He's got this, he's got this other ability that makes his parry ability negate all the damage and lower his cooldown the more hits you take. So you can become pretty untouchable in some situations if you play your cards right. Although, I've actually really taken to his Twin Blades of Fury, where he splits his swords apart. He can also be pretty survivable in this way. I think he's got a talent that will grant him healing every time he hits with his heroic strike. And because you're hitting so often with two swords, that cooldown comes up. So, but we'll see. I think when I'm gonna be saving. Particular for Ragnaros, because I just prefer his character a little bit more.
Sure, sure.
Yeah, Varian is a lot of fun. Okay, I would encourage you to play it.
Yeah, no, I'll head over to the room and give it a shot. So, one more. What's your favorite skin in the entire game?
Shadow Poly.
Nice.
So much fun.
Cool.
Cute. Really, lots of little details.
Nice. Very cool. Well, thank you so much for your time. I really appreciate it.